story that highlighted his, quote, redemption season with the Miami Heat when he won his first title after coming up short the previous year against the Mavericks. LeBron titled the repost in his story with, quote, "It's not about if you fail, it's about how you come back," followed by the crown emoji. He loves the crown emoji. He uses that one a lot. Shannon, why did LeBron post this?
Yeah, man. Y'all must be thinking me and Bron best friends or something.
Yes.
Well, that's what you indicate.
That's what I think.
I mean, I thought you said
you're the fifth horseman, right?
Look, everybody is not going to be fortunate like Magic. Get to the NBA, win a championship. Larry, second year, win a championship. Tim Duncan, championship. Everybody is not like that. Most of the time, the greats have had to endure year after year after year of coming up short before they finally break through. And I will concede this, LeBron's 2011 finals was epically bad. Mm. But to overcome that, to become a two-time MVP, to win four championships and to be finals MVP and to be all NBA after all of that, he said, like, look, okay, yeah, I failed. But it's not about failing, because we're all going to fail at some point in time. What do you become? What do you do after the failure? Mm. And he's like, and he's probably looking at it like this year. Yeah, I got hurt. But you remember what happened the last time I got hurt? I arrived in L.A., I got hurt. And what happened? I followed it up. I got hurt again. And guess what's going to happen? Mm. I'm going to follow it up. Mm. So he's saying, like, look, and you know, a lot of times we equate things to sports, but even in life, you don't get the job or you get terminated from a job. It's not about that. It happens. What are you going to do after it happens? LeBron says, I'm going to rise up. Rise up. Mm. I'm still the king. And you're going to find out the hard way.
Huh.
Yeah, I see.
So is this a championship prediction for next year?
Could be.
Could be? Or is?
Could be.
Oh, it's cryptic.
Yeah, so that's what we do.
You don't have to really go on record. Yeah. You don't actually post.
That's what we do.
We will win the championship.
The Da Vinci Code.
That would take some guts, man.
The Da Vinci Code. Figure it out.
You have to be cryptic. You have to sort of tiptoe around.
You can figure it out. That's what you do. You dock the field over there.
Mm-hmm. It's another vow, another warning from the king, right? Just like, remember the first year in L.A.? Going into playoff mode early. And
it didn't happen.
You missed the playoffs.
And then what happened the next year?
So that was it. That had to set up the next year. I guess that's what it was. Okay, so here we go again. And I don't disagree with the sort of the logic of this, the premise of this. It's like a cliche almost, you know. It's not about if you fail, it's about how you come back. Okay, I get it.
Yeah.
You know, that's like just a life principle for most people.
Yeah.
But you keep telling me day after day after day after day, talk about being exhausted from something. You keep telling me this man is the GOAT, greatest of all time.
Yep.
Correct?
Yep.
So why would you talk about failing if you're the greatest of all time? Because there shouldn't be much failure on your resume. And unfortunately, his resume is potholed. It's pockmarked with epic failure all the way through it, year after year after year, epic fails. He is 4-6 in the NBA Finals. And I don't know why you would bring it up. It's like, first of all, I keep telling you about LeBron. Don't tell me. Just show me. Just go do it.
He did that. Okay? And you still don't want to believe it.
Don't talk about it. Be about it. Go do it. As Nike always said from the start, pre-LeBron, just do it, LeBron, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so in the end, it is about failing if you're saying you're the GOAT, because you can't disqualify your previous failure by saying, well, but look how I bounce back.
Right.
Well, a lot of times you didn't bounce back.
He did.
Way too many times you didn't bounce back because you've lost 6 finals, right?
And he bounced back.
Okay, just because people are going to say, you're piling on. No, I'm not piling on. He started it. He brought up failure. So can we count the ways quickly that he has failed in his career? And tell me exactly how many times he bounced back from this. Because in 2007, everybody said, LeBron's got next. He is it. He's the next MJ. And he lost all 4 games to the Spurs. At least you could take one off the Spurs because you were that good. You're that dynamic.
So what was Michael Jordan doing at 22?
Okay, fine. Let's go to 2009. you hit the shot heard round the world. I never, you want to talk about being exhausted from something. It was game two at Cleveland. Remember, he hits the shot of shots.
Yeah, against Orlando.
Hedo Turkoglu. I don't know what he was doing because LeBron, he's like playing him to drive. Yeah. You have no choice. You got to catch it and shoot it because the game's going to be over. And he made it. Way to go.
Okay.
And then he fell on his face. Everybody said, here comes Kobe LeBron in the finals, and they're doing the Muppet commercials. Yep. And you know, remember that? Yep. And he fell on his face. And then we go to 2010.
38-8-8 falling on his face. But okay, I get you.
2010. Well, look at games. What was it, like 3, 4, 5?
They lost in six.
Okay. 2010, Boston, you're up, you're in commanding position, and you lose games 4, 5, and 6 to such a point that your owner accuses you of quitting. And then somebody from your camp tells somebody at ESPN that you had to be sedated because you were having an issue with a teammate in the locker room. You had to be sedated before each of those games, 4, 5, and 6. Sedated? You're kidding. Then 2011 happened. And at least you do acknowledge that. It was the all-time epic superstar meltdown. Never seen anything like it in games 4, 5, and 6 against Dallas after you were up 2-1. And then they did break through finally in 2012, and LeBron had to say, it's about damn time. Yeah. Remember, that's what he said on the court right after the game. It's about damn time. It was against the baby thunder of Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook and James Harden. They were babies. They didn't know, and LeBron took them to school. Way to go. And then Ray Allen saved his legacy.
No, he just saved.
He came all apart down the stretch of that game. And
7-10 in the fourth quarter.
And then he followed that up by getting blown off the floor by a record margin by my Spurs in the 2014 finals.
You talk about how he came apart in 2008. You do realize they put the big three together to take LeBron down after they saw what he had done to the Bad Boy Pistons, too, that was running the East.
Okay.
They ran the East, and a 22-year-old took him down. Mm. Paul Pierce couldn't do it by himself. Mm. So what did they do? They made the trade for KG. They made the trade for Ray Allen. They already had Rondo. Mm-hmm. So they put that team together. That was a big three in the modern time. There have been big threes before. The Lakers had them in the 80. The Celtics had them in the 80. The Sixers had a big three.
Okay. Remember, in Game 3 at Boston Garden, LeBron played, I thought, his greatest game ever. You've argued that other, the Game 6 against
game
Boston,
six, yeah.
And they're 50-50 to me, and I give you both of them. But listen, in that Friday night Game 3 at Boston, he was unstoppable, just dominated the Celtics, and they went up 2-1, and then this happened.
Okay, Skip, but they lost, but I'm saying.
Okay.
But you're criticizing.
Let's just keep going. Let's go to 2015. He played the three greatest in a stretch, three greatest games I've ever seen him play. And they're up 2-1 with game four in his house against Golden State before it was really Golden State.
Right.
And he had lost Kyrie and he had lost
before
Kevin
it was
Love.
Golden State, but they still had an MVP.
Well, he was on the bench at that point, named Iguodala.
No, I'm not talking about no Iguodala. I'm talking about the Steph.
Oh, well, because all of a sudden, Steve Kerr goes with Andre Iguodala in the starting lineup. Game four in LeBron's house. And I thought, this is going to be LeBron's greatest moment. And he just disappears in game four, and that was the end of that
deal. Can you tell me the difference from LeBron James having a 2-1 lead against Golden State with Steph, Klay and Draymond versus KD having a 2-0 lead against Giannis. Mm-hmm. What's the difference?
What's the difference?
Yes.
Well, he had them down 2-1.
You had them down. You had them down 2-0.
Game four in your palace.
You had them down 2-0. You had them 3-2. You lost game seven. So what's the difference?
Well, you made the shot that I thought beat them, and you had 1/10 of a toenail on the line.
No, Skip.
I'm just saying, he did what he needed to do.
No, he did not. Yeah. He needed to hit a three. So this is what I love about sports, about our sports, about basketball, about football, about baseball. There is no subjectivity. Mm. It's not platform springboard diving. Mm-hmm. It's not gymnastics. Mm-hmm. You don't leave it up to the judge. Mm. Either you win or you lose. So I just want you to tell me the difference between what KD had, 2-0 lead and losing, or a 3-1 lead and losing. What was the difference?
Okay, but he lost the two games, obviously, on the road. He didn't get that game where you're up 2-1 in your house. It's a big advantage for LeBron. He's a whole game up on his rival.
So you're saying with what KD had, KD up 2-0. And his roster is worse than LeBron being up 2-1 on Golden State.
Yeah. What do you mean worse?
Like his roster, the supporting cast, Blake Griffin and the guys that he had, they were worse than what LeBron.
Well, they never had a lead, right? They never got up on, you know, where they broke serve, you know.
We're 2-0. That's breaking serve.
But LeBron won, thanks to Dellavedova, one game.
You see what you did?
Well,
Well,
Deli made this shot. Okay, well,
So what role did Jeff Green play in that historic performance that KD had?
Both he and Blake were both very good.
But you didn't say it was a virtual.
Well, you see what you did? Well, it just was. But I admit that. But I just told you the greatest three-game stretch I've ever seen LeBron play. Remember, he was dominating. He was like 60% usage rate where he just had the ball in his hands, slowed the game down.
That was all
they
could do.
And they could not stop him for three games.
Right.
One, two, and three in his house.
But when people said LeBron got tired, you said he couldn't get tired. But then in game six and seven, when KD lost both of those games, and you said he got tired. Well, LeBron can't get tired, but KD can.
Okay, but KD didn't get tired until overtime when he just hit the wall.
He can't get tired,
period. The whole game, and he didn't have Kyrie. And James Harden was a liability. I don't care what anybody says. He was slowing everything down. He couldn't run at all.
Skip.
Remember the fast break where it looked like he was just going to get loose, and he just pulls up and lets everybody run by him?
Can we stop this notion? Every great player.